Hey, howdy, hey, everybody. Nick Train 123 here, back using my voice again for the first time in over 15 years. Like, has it been that long? You may remember a while ago, I made a video about the LBSCR E2s, questioning if they really are not as bad as we think. I brought up some good points about their design and set the record straight on some misconceptions about them. The video was decent and all, but after some further analysis and some input from friends, I felt the need to do a revision and follow-up video to it, as many of the pointers I made turn out don't even really need to be fixed on the E2s at all. After a while of researching, however, it turns out there isn't actually that much about the E2s in what's already online, and I went and got myself some books for further research. After doing some reading, it turns out that barely even a fourth of the information about the E2s is even on the internet, and I decided to do instead a complete history video about them, featuring not only about their design, but their service history, where they worked, where they were stationed, and all that in between. There's so much info which I try to cover in this video, and even then I could barely fit it all in here, especially from footplate days of the Southern, which is a highly detailed account of a driver working with the E2s on the footplate, which I highly recommend you get a copy for yourself to read. Now, before we begin the video, I just wanted to say, as I said before, any opinions I have in this video are purely of my own. Feel free to continue to think of these engines any which way you want. While this is a complete history video, I will be elaborating further on their faults and possible fix in another video, so keep watching that till the end of this for a special teaser. You may notice I also used a lot of influence from both High Iron and Terrier 55 Stepney in the making of this video. Both have been a big inspiration and influence for me, and I thank them very much for making such awesome videos about rally history. I'd also like to thank fellow X-Users Crankster and Tomo the for providing the E2 photos I used in this video. We gathered as much information as we could and put it all into a Google Drive archive, which I provided a link for in the description below. And of course, thank you guys for watching this video. I hope you guys enjoy it. This one's going to be a bit of a doozy, so bear with me. So, without any further ado, after nearly 2 years in production, here it is. The complete history of the London, Brighton, and South Coast Railway E2s. Lawson B. Billinton was born on February 4, 1882, to parents Robert and Alice Billinton. Robert served as chief mechanical engineer for the London, Brighton, South Coast Railway from 1890 to 1904. Robert was a well-respected locomotive engineer who made many successful engine and carriage designs. Some of his most famous engines were the C2s, the B4s, E3s, E4s, E5s, and E6s. Lawson started out as a cycle maker and investor in the early automotive industry, but followed closely in his father's footsteps in locomotive engineering. He tutored under his father Robert at Brighton Works in 1900 and took on several jobs such as a thinner's apprentice, draftsman, and inspector of materials. Robert Billinton was succeeded by Douglas E. Marsh in 1904, who appointed the young Lawson in charge of the experimental department of Brighton Works. Here, he oversaw developments in adding electric lighting and passenger coaches, as well as testing the feasibility of motor train services. July 1, 1911 would see the resignation of D.E. Marsh. Despite having the minimalist amount of experience with the role, the board unanimously agreed to appoint Lawson Billinton as Marsh's replacement. Now Lawson was finally on top of the ladder as chief engineer of the railway, as his father had once been. But the engineering department was in shambles. By 1911, much of the LBSCR stock was beyond their expiration dates. Marsh had tried to salvage as much as he could, rebuilding older engines with larger boilers. But some 30% of the total engines were lying out of service awaiting overhauls, and Brighton simply could not keep up with repair orders. Lawson Billinton immediately got to work, replacing Marsh's recycle policy with a scrap and replace order. One of his main focuses was to find a suitable replacement for the old six-couple tank engines, including Stradley's antiquated A1 and E1 tank engines. Marsh had already taken one E1 locomotive and rebuilt with a larger boiler, like those he fitted on the D1X and I2 class engines. The result was the LBSCR E1X. Number 89 Brest emerged from Brighton Works in her new form in January 1911. New boiler measured 4 feet 6 inches in diameter. New side tanks were also added, along with a new bunker, cab, and smoke box saddle patented after Marsh's own design. While the result looked pretty impressive for a shunter, the rebuild proved to be a dismal failure. The boiler and tanks were top heavy. When the tanks were full, their weight was put on the running plate and stressed the supporting bands on the boiler. This made it an unsteady rider on curves and crossovers, and as a result, an order signed in May 1912 forbade the E1X from pulling passenger trains. It was restricted to shunting duties till 1930 when it was finally reverted back into its original shape.
Lawson began plans for a new 06L couple tank engine for shunting duties in November 1911, submitted draw numbers 1008 to Brighton Works, recommending at least 20 of these engines should be built by way of renewals. By October 1912, Brighton Works had started the construction of the first batch of five, with number 100 leading the erecting shops in June 1913. Numbers 101 through 104 followed shortly after through to January 1914, taking approximately 2 months to build each engine. Classified as E2s, the new tank engines followed a similar design to the E1X, 44-foot 6-inch drive wheels, slotted frames, and 17.5x26-inch cylinders. Coal capacity was rated at 2.5 tons, with water tank capacity at 1,090 gallons. They carried over the boilers from the I2s to cut costs, as well as for the E2s to be mounted with a wear pump and hot water injectors, with the intention to be used for high-pressure steam. Billings declined to fit the E2s with superheating, seeing it unnecessary for shunting engines to have it. They were already strong enough at a pulling power of 21,307 pounds. Top speed was estimated to be at around 70 miles per hour. As the cherry on top of the cake, Lawson retained the smoke box design used by Marsh before him to complete the look of a modern, beefy, compact, stumpy little tank engine that looked just about ready to do anything. Unfortunately, that was so far from the truth. The first E2, number 100, was sent to work in the shunting yards of the midday goods out of Eastbourne to the ballast hole on the Crumbles Beach. This provided shingle for the LBSCR to use as track ballast, as well as for the Midland Railway to stabilize their coal lines. The rest of the four bounced around the other major shunting yards on the network, including Brighton, Battersea, and Newcross. Railway cracks began to show in the E2's design. The tanks were said to be of insufficient water capacity, and the coal bunker too small. Ironically, the E2 shared the same coal capacity with Robert Billington's E3 and E4 locomotives, yet they were decent steamers. Actually, it was the I2 type boiler that was too quick to consume both coal and water, being designed for high pressure steam but with an insufficient heating surface in the firebox. Basically saying the boiler expected too much steam, but there was too little heat to produce it. The boiler was said to be adequate enough for shunting, but not for hauling freight or pasture trains. Rough riding and oscillation was also an issue. At 50 miles per hour, it was reported the engines were very unsteady. It was likely due to the fact that E2s were very tall and the water tanks mounted high on the frame. The crew often had to hang off the capsize for dear life, being tossed around like a ship on a stormy sea. Gas space was also constrictive. If the fireman wasn't careful, he would easily get bonked in the ass by either the regulator or the reverser. Westinghouse air brakes were mounted on the E2s to allow them to be compatible with older rolling stock. It actually worked well. Too well. Crews had to be most careful manning the brake, otherwise the engine would stop or start too quickly. In fact, the air brakes were so sharp that if an E2 was pushing stock and if the brake was put on too quickly, the sudden halt would cause the wagon coupling to break like a twig.
Oh no!
Both 103 and 104 were tried in motor trains running in between two sets of three coaches at each end between London Bridge, Forest Hill, and Crystal Palace. However, their unsteadiness at speed and accelerating and reportedly throwing molten coals out both the smokestack and the firebox door ensured the E2s were no good at pasture runs. Even as shunters, their elongated wheelbase prevented them from taking the tighter curves most suited for shorter engines. Good strains were also a challenge for them. Sure, the E2s were strong and had good brakes for shunting, but loose coupled good strains and only 3 axles of braking power were not a good combination.
Now, I know what you must be thinking at this point. This makes the E2s sound like pretty awful engines to you, doesn't it? Well, here's the thing. The E2's core purpose was for shunting, and they were designed to do just that. When you're designing an engine for shunting as opposed to pasture or freight duties, there are different factors you gotta consider. A strong boiler in short bursts is more ideal for shunting than pulling actual trains, and that's exactly what the I2 boiler delivered, despite the small firebox. The E2s were based off the E1X design, so a lot of their faults were inherited from their predecessor, but the E2s were still miles better in terms of performance. Even D.L. Bradley in Locomotive LBSCR Volume 3 called the E2s an quote-unquote unqualified success. Lawson did have some fixes in mind for the E2s to improve their usefulness, but the LBSCR was so stripped for funds and the fact that there were other engines readily available to fill the niches, they didn't see any more mods necessary. Lawson was able to extend the tanks on the next batch of E2s, however, as well as elongating the body by about 3.5 inches longer than the first batch. The new tanks increased the E2's water capacity to 1,256 gallons, and the air-assisted screw-and-handle reversing system was retained for all 5 engines. The ascension of the water tanks may have increased their capacity, but the class was still found to consume water rather quickly. The second batch cost 2,217 pounds per engine, with 5 built, numbered from 105 to 109. This brought the total number of E2s to 10. Because of the high cost to build each engine plus World War I limiting the material needed to build them, the LBSCR opted not to build any more E2s. During the First World War, the E2s found themselves in London being used as pilots and working empty coaches in and out of London Bridge and Victoria and the carriage sidings. But with the increased demand of wartime, they were required to run wagons out to the Northern Railways. Number 105 was assigned first to Battersea, and then the three bridges to assist in marshalling goods trains coming to and from the Midland, Great Western, Great Northern, and London and Northwestern Railways. Numbers 106, 107, and 108 were also sent to three bridges. However, the local crews much preferred to use the E3s, so the E2s were returned to Battersea. During the war, the LBSCR raised their wages. In 1921, Lawson was instructed to carry out a series of time and motion studies to point out likely economies in the railway department to be used to save costs. E2 number 109 was fitted with a service moving recorder to monitor its performance as a shunter. The amount of shunters could be cut down to 11 engines being used at one time, thus saving money for the LBSCR to cut running costs. In 1923, the LBSCR was grouped with several other railways to become the Southern Railway. The E2s had prior been painted in Marsh's old goods black and umber brown liveries. Now they were all being painted in the Southern Railway's line black goods livery. By this time, Lawson was only 40, but the Southern Railway elected to replace him with Richard Monzel as a new chief mechanical engineer. This prompted Lawson to take an early retirement from railway engineering, which shocked many of the workforce at Brighton. But it was not met without warm wishes and farewells from the men who worked with him over the years. Despite not being as well remembered as his predecessors, Lawson actually did pretty well as the last chief mechanical engineer of the LBSCR. The E2s were only the first engines he designed himself. He later went on to create the K-Class 260s and L1 remembrance tanks. He also worked with the Royal Engineers during World War I to help repair railways in Russia and Romania, and advocated for women to be treated with the same respect as men in the railway workplace. Mad respect to you, Lawson. You had a good run. In the meantime, the Southern Railway continued the LBSCR's ambitions to electrify their entire network, but the E2s themselves still received some attention. Vacuum ejectors and steam heating equipment were fitted alongside the old Westinghouse air brake system between 1923 and 24. Not much changed in the line of duties at first, but a coal strike in 1926 saw a brief return of the E2s to pasture work. Numbers 103, 104, 106, and 107 were seen quite often running pasture trains between London Bridge, Forest Hill, and Crystal Palace once again. Even 109 got the chance while it was on loan to Tunbridge Wells West, and was seen quite often doing pasture duties alongside the morning pickup goods to three bridges. Previously in 1923, the Southern Railway designated all Brighton-built engines with the prefix B added to the front of the numbers. This included the E2s, which were numbered B100 through B109. By 1931, the B was dropped and replaced with the 2000 prefix. Now the E2s are numbered 2100 through 2109. When the third rail finally sank its way into London Victoria, many of the E3s and E4s were displaced from the local commuters. A lot of them were relegated to shunting duties around the London area, and they began to displace E2s from their shunting duties. There was no danger of them being scrapped, however. Yet. With the I2s being cut up in the 1930s, this left a large surplus of boilers to be used by the E2s. The class was split into two, and they were swamped in between Battersea and New Cross. Mostly you'd see them shunting empty coaches, but when the old SCCRT Class 060 tanks were withdrawn in 1936, the E2s were dispatched to Herne Hill for marshalling duties and banking. For Herne Hill duties and around Victoria, the E2s were all allocated to Battersea, aside from 2106 and 2107, who were set aside for a very special job. The night ferry service was inaugurated on the 14th of October 1936. It was a nighttime boat train service meant to supplement the daytime Golden Arrow, and ran between London and Paris via ferry in between Dunkirk and Dover. 2106 and 2107 were both assigned to Dover Harbor to assist in shunting the boat train carriages on and off the ferry. Given the E2's reputation of being rough shunters, it must have been quite a shock they, of all engines, were given the honor of shunting the night ferry. But it was their strength that made them ideal for the task at hand, and the crews must have had to handle them very carefully when shunting the coaches so as not to wake the sleeping passengers.
Shh. Be very, very quiet. You're shunting sleepers.
Yes.
During the 1930s and into the 40s, the E2s continued to get some modifications. The smoke boxes were reconstructed with rivets, and the lining on the Monzel Goods black livery was dropped as a result of the Great Depression. In December 1939, however, number 2100 became the first of the class to receive the new bullied sunshine livery, with 2109 falling shortly after in February 1940. The edges of the cab roof were trimmed to conform to the Southern's smaller loading gauge, along with the buffer beams. This also meant the whistle had to be moved from the cab roof to the side of the safety valve. Previously, crews complained that if the whistle was blown at full blast, it would rattle the cab roof. Must have been somewhat of a relief to have the whistle moved off the roof.
Ah, much better.
The footsteps are also angled on the edges. I'm guessing so that crews don't have their feet slip on the steps if they're wet or icy. All modifications were done at Eastley Works, as the Southern Railway designated as their main engine repair facilities after the grouping in 1923. In 1939, German troops invaded Poland despite warnings from Great Britain or allies of retaliation. This resulted in the Second World War. A pair of Z-Class 080s working at Hither Green released to the War Department. Hither Green borrowed a pair of E2s, numbers 2108 and 2109, to take their place in December 1942. They were not well received by the crews and weren't used that much in the nearby yards. The crews much preferred the ancient Stirling 01060s, despite they had cumbersome tenders, poor footplate protection, and blackout problems. The Zs were returned to January 1944, and the E2s were sent straight to Ashford as quickly as possible. After the fall of France, the night ferry services were put on hold. Both 2105 and 2106 were laid aside in storage for a week or so before they were sent to Battersea. On the way, they were stopped at Tonbridge as shunters were needed to man the East Yard for a few days. Meanwhile, 2108 and 2109 had trouble finding suitable work in Ashford, except as wagon works pilots. Little use was made of them until preparations for D-Day necessitated them to be at Dover Harbor. It was here on the 11th of June 1944, just 4 days after the Second Front, 2109 got caught up in an attack on Dover, where she was showered from shell splinters from the German long-range guns. She was only slightly damaged, but continued running as normal. Miraculously, all 10 members of the E2 class made it through denationalization in 1948. The Southern Railway, along with the rest of the Big Four, were combined under government control to form British Railways. In the few short years following nationalization, railway author H. Norman worked with the E2s at Herne Hill. His accounts of working with the E2s can be found in his Footplate Days of the Southern book. 8 of the E2s, save for 32108 and 32109, which were still based at Dover, the rest of the 8 were allocated to Stewart Lane Depot. Speaking of which, under BR, the E2s were renumbered in the 30,000 series, so now the numbers read at 32100 through 32109. It took a while to repaint them all in the BR colors. Some remained in the Southern's bully black with the BR numbers patched on them. At least 32102 is lucky enough to get British Railways lettering done in the style of bullied yellow and green lettering. By 1951, all 10 E2s had been painted in BR black, sporting the Lion and Cycle logo and given the 3F power rating. Lamp irons were added on the smoke box door, along with number plates and shed plates to tell which shed the E2s were stationed at. The condensing gear, wear pumps, and hot water injectors were all removed, with the latter being replaced by Ashford patterned injectors. Some of the E2s also received metal patchwork on their bunkers for some reason. You'd be surprised to know at this point, the E2s mostly retained their original boilers from when they were built. 32104, however, received another I-2 type boiler, number 576, during a visit to Ashford Works in December 1953. This boiler had been carried over from E4X number 32477, which gave 32104 clack boxes on the barrel sides and had a flatter dome shape, singling her out in style from her classmates. This unfortunately made no improvements to steaming performance on the E2s, so none of the other class members received any more E4X boilers. Trips to and from the works gave the E2s a chance to take on various duties along the way. 32108 was noted to have taken a spin with the 8:40 p.m. Eastbourne to Hastings freight on January 14, 1953. Meanwhile, 32109 performed graveyard duty on her way back to Dover. She was tasked to take 3:14:77, a withdrawn D-Class 440 from Tonbridge to Ashford to be cut for scrap. Into the late 50s and early 60s, the E2s bounced around various depots, including Stewart's Lane, Brighton, Bricklayer's Arms, Norwood Junction, Eastley, and Nine Elms. In 1955, British Railways issued the modernization plan, with the end goal of modernizing the rail network. This involved abandoning redundant and run-down lines that were running in the red, along with the end goal of replacing steam traction with diesel and electric locomotives. By November 1956, 32108 and 32109 were no longer needed to shunt the night ferry services at Dover, and the two were sent to Eastleigh. But they weren't down and out just yet, for there was still one last call of duty for the E2s yet. Southampton Docks. Here the little shunters made themselves quite at home, working in the shadows of titanic cranes and great ocean-going vessels. Crews of the E2s would have regularly seen many of the famous ocean liners of the day, including Cunard's Queen Elizabeth, Queen Mary, and the SS United States, the fastest ship on the ocean. At first, it was just 32108 and 32109, but eventually the rest of the class joined them working along the dockways. Some of the E2s that worked at the docks were modified with steps and grab irons for the bunker. Usually, there were three in steam at one time, with one on the reserve at Southampton Dock Shed. The others were based at Eastleigh, with one usually shunting the works yard and another acting as shed pilot. The E2s made themselves quite at home at Southampton. However, they could not take the tight curves of the dock railway, as they weren't built with taking tight curves in mind. This is where their colleagues came in. After World War II, the Southern Railway purchased a number of S-100-060 tanks built for the United States Army Transportation Corps by American firms Porter and Vulcan. The USAs were already working around Southampton docks prior to the E2's arrival since 1946, despite popular belief the USAs came after the E2s and actually replaced them. This wasn't the case at all. While Southampton did have 13 USA-class tanks at their disposal, their small bunkers did make them limited in range, and other engines had to be brought in to supplement them. E2s and USAs worked symbiotically together, with the E2s taking the longer duties for the USAs, and the USAs able to take the tighter corners with their 10-foot wheelbase. Alongside the 13 Yank tanks and the 10 E2s, some of the B-4040 tanks from the London Southwestern Railway also worked with them around the docks. Also joining them at the docks was Stradley E1 number 32694, the last of its class to work under BR. In 1958, the crew of Railway Roundabout came to Southampton docks and filmed footage of the E2s and the USAs at work. The TV documentary made good note of the dock engines using radio telephone communication and cabbed the shore system to help control movements around the docks. This was quite efficient and unique to Great Britain. The engines were fitted with whip aerials, radio telephones, and turbo generators to supply the electricity needed to power them. Crews protested at first, but then they realized just how useful the radio systems actually were, especially for calling for relief crews or knowing when their shifts ended at a moment's notice. By 1962, the diesel locomotive had finally caught up to the E2s and USAs at Southampton docks. Rustin and Hornsby built 14 BR Class 07-060 shunters, built specially to take the dock railway's tight curves. The sound of their horn marked the end of the E2's working lives. The first to be condemned was 32107 in February 1961. Whilst the rest of the class managed to linger on for about two more years. Eastleigh Works, which had been the E2's last refuge from dieselization, was the place where the class was sent to be cut up for scrap. After 32107, 32102, and 32100 followed shortly after in October and November 1961. 32108 was withdrawn in June 1962. 32101 and 32105 bowed out together in September 1962. With 32103 and 32106 following in October that same year. The last of the class to be withdrawn was 32104 and 32109 in April of 1963. 50 years in service the E2s lasted, with some class members working up an average of 700,000 miles. Quite impressive for mere shunting engines. If Lawson himself is still alive at that point, no doubt he would have been impressed by how long his E2s lasted as they did, despite all the odds being against them. The last physical remnants of his career at Brighton were all lost to the gas axe, forever. But the story of the E2s doesn't quite end there. If you don't know the story already, there was a certain reverend based out of Ellsworth who wrote stories for children based around railway engines. In 1946, he wrote his second book about a cheeky little tank engine who worked at a big station as pilot engine. The little tank engine wanted to get out and see the world, and got into several scrapes along the way. Eventually, he performed a daring rescue, and was rewarded a branch line and two coaches to call his very own. It was up to artist Reginald Payne to bring the tank engine stories to life through his colorful illustrations, and a real-life basis for the tank engine had to be chosen. Previously, the Reverend, Wilbert Audrey, had created the tank engine as an 060 with soaked water tanks, which he made as a toy for his son, Christopher. The design itself is completely freelance, but Payne thought he could do better. Ultimately, Payne decided to base the character off the E2 tank engines, as he grew up in the south of England and would have seen them running on a regular basis. At first, Wilbert was annoyed his original design was not illustrated for the book, but after finding out Payne based the tank engine off a real-life engine, he was content and allowed this change to stay. It was thanks to Reginald Payne that the E2s were immortalized forever as the basis of Thomas the Tank Engine. Since its debut, Thomas had been a worldwide phenomenon, entertaining both children, adults, and all fans of railways alike for over 79 years. Thomas's legacy has been both a blessing and a curse for the E2s. Whilst Thomas did help to bring attention to the E2s to the modern world, his reputation has largely overshadowed the legacy of his basis. When someone thinks of the E2s, they always think of Thomas, not the plucky little shunting engines that work the backyards of the Brighton network. The E2s remain to this day as one of the most personalized and iconic steam trains in pop culture, for better or for worse. Many in the rail enthusiast circuit will also remember the E2s for their disabilities over their achievements. In reality, the E2s really weren't the worst at Brighton, nor were they the best. They did what they were built for and did it to the best of their abilities for as long as they lasted, and that at least is deserving of some respect. The debate will probably continue on for as long as humanity exists, but people need to remember concerning the E2s, that if you truly want to know if something is good or bad, you gotta look deeper than what's on the surface to see its true worth. All you gotta do is look at the entire story. And I'll bet you wondered this at some point. If Thomas really is an E2, just how did he escape Brighton and make it all the way to the northwest of England? How did he succeed where the E2s failed in pulling passenger and goods trains and secure his own branch line? How did Thomas become, to put in a quote, really useful? Well, that, my friends, is a whole other story on its own.